Hi everyone, here's the Bookchemist once again, and these are some of the reasons why I really liked Dominicana by Angie Cruz, and why I think you should read it too. It's a great novel. The first one might be ever so slightly weird, but I think that Dominicana is an excellent apartment novel. I'm a big fan of apartments, I've lived in apartments virtually all my life, and I think it's a rather peculiar type of living, quite dissimilar from all other types really, and I think Dominicana explores its implications and the ways it influence your everyday life very effectively and very interestingly. Unless you're a movie star with a view on Central Park, if you live in an apartment, chances are your living space might be ever so slightly cramped, your kitchen might be just about large enough to contain two people standing up, your living room will sometimes have to double as a dining room, as an entertainment space, perhaps even as a guest bedroom. Most likely you'll be immersed in the life of your city, and that's definitely the case for Anna, the protagonist in Dominicana, who moves to Manhattan very early into the novel, in ways that just don't happen if you, say, live in the suburbs, or even just in a purely residential neighborhood. All sorts of exchanges, from business exchanges to artistic ones, from the very interesting to the very grotty, are likely to happen just outside your window, just outside your front door. Similarly, if you live in an apartment, your relationship with your neighbors is going to be an ambivalent one. You and all these other people live in the same building, share the same physical space, but at the same time, your own apartment, your own dimension, is actually quite self-contained. And within an apartment building, you can be as civic-minded or antisocial as you want. You can spend decades living there without ever interacting with the people living on the same floor as you, or you can perhaps clean the hallway every once in a while, or help your neighbors with their chores and their needs. Anna, at various points in the novel, will adopt both attitudes and will embrace both sides of this ambivalent dimension. And this, by the way, is not really different from what happens if you live in a house, say, if you live on a row of terraced houses, or even if you live on a cul-de-sac, really. It's just that apartment buildings, because they force you and your neighbors to live in the same shell, in the same physical space, collapse that illusion that exists if your house and the next house is separated by a garden and maybe a picket fence, that rather misguided illusion that your own property, the land on which you live, is your land, and that whatever happens beyond the edge, beyond your picket fence, is not really your problem, it's somebody else's. Dominicana talks very naturally and very beautifully about all the dynamics of apartment life. Anna gets on her neighbor's nerves, but then becomes friends with them and helps them dealing with their own needs and their own problems. Her kitchen becomes a space where she can entertain friends and where she can establish deep connections. Her apartment will at times feel like a cage, and at other times it feels like a launching pad into all of the wonders that New York City has to offer. At various times, it even becomes her shop, her own business, a place where she can meet clients and develop her own business and her own independence, really, but a place where she is also at risk of making enemies. What I found especially beautiful was experiencing how Anna, from being a bit scared and a bit confused by her block and her immediate neighborhood, eventually comes to take ownership of it and comes to realize that that's her home and that it belongs to her, and decides to become part of that life, to become an active component in the life of her neighborhood, be it helping her neighbors, as I said, being by it experiencing more of the social and nightlife that the neighborhood has to offer. It was a really invigorating and insightful experience. Perhaps because books themselves are a little bit like apartments, they are self-contained spaces that look like they are worlds into their own right, but in fact they are intimately connected with all other books and all other stories that went into them and come out of them. Perhaps because there's this similarity between the space and the medium, I really like curling up in a book the way you retreat into your own apartment on a rainy day, and Dominicana is an excellent book for that. I really love spending time in Anna's apartment. I only hope I didn't leave too many crumbs on the couch. Second reason why I think Dominicana is great is that Angie Cruz is really masterful at painting her characters as fully fledged, convincing human beings. The protagonist in this novel is Anna, a young woman, but really at the beginning of the novel she's actually still a girl, who is forced by the historical moment she's living in and by the needs of her family to marry a man who's much older than her and to move to a foreign country. And Juan, the man who will become her husband, is a little bit like America, where she moves to. It's not like Anna necessarily despises them. And in fact, both the place and the man have some rather flashy, rather compelling sides to them. It's just that if she'd had any say in the matter at all, I really doubt that she would have married him or moved there. Now, it is really difficult in fiction, even for the best crafted characters, to avoid falling into stereotypes or into tropes or into expectations, into these roles of the hero, the anti-hero, the villain. Writers, even really talented ones, are writing against the laws of semiotics, the very basic fact that we make sense of stories by referring to all the other stories we'd heard before, and all those stories also contained those tropes and those larger-than-life figures. Writers who strive to create full-fledged, well-rounded, three-dimensional characters are in a way writing against the very grain of storytelling. Even just because in a novel, which especially a rather short one like Dominicana, you can only really convey the psychology of a character through a few snippets into their minds, through a few reflections, a few snapshots from their life. It's inevitable for these fragments to then expand into the mind of the reader and create a character who is maybe blacker or whiter, and whose shades of grey are only really marginal and tangential. And yet Cruz is incredibly talented, and in a very natural way, when it comes to keeping her characters away from these narrative extremes and making them stand out as convincingly human. Anna's mom, for instance, in the book, is a rather ghastly woman and very much of a bully, but I wouldn't call her a monster, and I don't think I would even call her a villain, really. Cesar, who is in many ways one of the novel's heroes, I would say, he is really nice, really funny, really has a huge heart. At the same time, sometimes clearly can see how the consequences of his actions have terrible implications and affect the people around him, the people he loves, in terrible ways. The greatness of Cruz's characterization is never as noticeable as with Juan, Anna's husband, the de facto co-protagonist of the novel. In many ways, Juan is a horrible person, and he behaves horribly toward Anna throughout the entire book. And yet Cruz is also able to show you, and again in a very natural way, that's really, really difficult, how Juan is also capable of great love and has some rather luminous sides. In fact, my impression from reading Dominicana is that Juan emerged as a tragic more than an aggressive figure, a victim of his own times, of his historical moment, what he perceived as his commitments and his obligations to his family, to himself. He emerges as a weak person who takes out his own frustration on people who he sees as even weaker than him, rather than a monster or somebody who's simply evil and nasty. All of these in no ways excuses Juan. I'm not just saying, oh, poor him. You can still blame him, you can still think he's a horrible person, I certainly do. But understanding the reasons behind his behavior is truly empowering and illuminating, and allows you to think of him and to people who maybe share some of his characteristics in ways that are quite invigorating and I would say, quite useful and illuminating. Being able to illuminate characters in this way denotes immense skills with the craft of storytelling and makes books such as Dominicana truly empowering. The only other writer I can think of who has the same skills can pull off the same tricks when it comes to portraying such deeply human characters as products of their times is Elena Ferrante. Finally, the last point I'll mention why I think Dominicana is really great, and this is the most obvious point, so I'll spend the least time on it, is that Dominicana is a truly invigorating and convincing immigrant story. It's a brilliant story about moving to a different country. It depicts in brilliant terms the fear and uncertainty when you leave the land that was everything that you knew, how you're attracted but also afraid of this new place, how you come to despise it because it's keeping you away from your homeland, how your family back home cannot possibly understand what you're going through and really start growing apart from your own experience and the way you see the world, how in time you start thinking about yourself as part of this new world and you come to accept its flaws and to be quite smitten with its luminous sides, and you end up feeling part of it and feeling empowered to become part of this new community when you come to live. I myself am somebody who left his home country to move somewhere else, which I thought would only be a temporary move, and instead it ended up becoming my new home. And I am in no way comparing my experience with Anna's. I was and I am immensely privileged. Anna really isn't. But I still can relate to Anna's story, and there was so much on it that felt familiar at a truly deep and meaningful level. I once read in a great book that human beings are like different types of bread. They're all different, they all have their own characteristics, but at heart they're all made of the same basic ingredients, and they are really made through the same process. And surely the key to happiness and harmony is to learn to appreciate our similarities at the same time as we celebrate our differences. That great book, by the way, was The River Cottage Guide to Bread, and the citation comes from the introduction by Hugh Fairley-Whittingstall. For all these reasons and more, I think that Dominicana really is an excellent novel, and I think you should read it, and I think you would have a great time with it. It's truly nourishing, truly stimulating, and beautiful in so many ways. What did you think of Dominicana if you've read it? Are you a fan, are you not? What did you think of other Angie Cruz novels? Is there any other that should really be on my radar? I look forward to discussing this and more in the comments below. Thank you so much for watching the video, everybody. Thank you to my patrons for supporting the YouTube channel. And I'll see you guys in the next review. Bye, everybody.